This morning we're going to continue on through the book of John. We're going to be in John 3, so we'll read that in just a minute together, but you can go ahead and flip to John 3 if you want. And I want us to just go to the Lord with a time in a time of prayer, seeking Him, seeking His presence with us as we read and study His holy word, His perfect word. And I want to pray, as I normally do, for another church here in Georgetown. We're going to pray for White Sulphur Baptist Church this morning. So let's pray together. Father, we are just in love with You as we sing and reflect on who You are today. Lord, You are the fount of every blessing, and it's every blessing that we don't deserve, God. And yet You bring those blessings to us, and we are overwhelmed in gratitude for what You have done. Lord, we're thankful that You are a God who lives and is alive in us and speaks to us even today as we read Your word and hear Your word together. Lord, we want to hear from You. We want to see how You speak directly into our lives. You meet us at our point of need. So, Father, that is our prayer, Lord, that we would encounter You in a very real way today, that we would see how great You are, how glorious You are, and that we would live changed by that great reality. Lord, You are great. Lord, we do pray for White Sulphur Baptist Church this morning, for Pastor Cravens there, and for the work that they're doing here in Scott County. God, we ask for Your hand to be on them, that they would serve You well, that they would be faithful to the gospel and making it known. We ask Your blessing on them as partners, brothers and sisters in Christ. Use them. So Lord, we just pray these things in Your name, the name of Jesus, the name above every name. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So last week we left off and we talked about on Easter how Jesus pointed to how His resurrection would change worship forever. We saw how He would destroy the temple. The temple would be destroyed, right? Not just the physical temple, His body. And that as a result, we would now be able to worship God through Jesus wherever we are. We're not confined to a place. And then we saw that there was this crowd of people that were following Jesus around in Jerusalem. And these people looked like they believed in Jesus. They saw these miracles that He was doing, and they said, wow, I believe in this guy. And yet Jesus pointed out to them that even though they trusted Him in some sense, He did not entrust Himself to them. He saw through their faith. And their faith wasn't genuine. And he pointed that out to them. Well, today we're going to pick up with that reality. We're going to see an example of one of these men who externally looked like he had the faith that he needed. But in reality, there was something missing from his life. It was just an external appearance. And Jesus points it out to him. This guy's name is Nicodemus, right? He was a man who thought he was good with God. He had done everything he thought he could do. But he was only fooling himself. He was fooling himself. And he was in danger as a result of it. And what we're going to see is something radical, something life-changing had to happen inside of him to make him right with God. So we're really going to spend the next two weeks, in John chapter 3. John chapter 3, I think we would all agree, is one of the most famous chapters in the Bible. I mean, you turn on the TV, you see football players with John 3:16 under their eyes, right? And signs holding up on TV, and so everybody quotes John 3:16. But really, John 3, the whole chapter of John 3, is all about God's salvation in us. And we need to know all of it. And what we're going to see today, we're going to focus first today on what God does and how He brings us into salvation. And then we're going to see next week, we're going to talk about John 3:16. We're going to see, okay, what is required of us in that process? So it's a both and, right? God is working, He's alive and He's active in bringing us to know Him, and yet we also have a responsibility. And so we're going to see both sides of that coin the next 2 weeks and how God brings about a life-changing salvation in us forever. We're going to see that. But the truth is, like Nicodemus this morning, I want us to think about ourselves, because we can fool ourselves just like he was fooling himself. We can do a lot of things. We can be very busy for God, and yet we can miss the whole point. And God wants us to see clearly that, look, if we're going to know Him And if we're going to be in His kingdom, if we're going to be in right standing with God and who He is, then we have to be completely made new. And the Bible calls this being born again. Being made completely brand new. All right, and so we're going to see kind of two realities in today's passage about what that means. What it means to be made new, to be born again, and how that comes about in our life. And so I want us to see, first of all, that we're going to have to recognize, look, we have to be made new. That's the first point that we have to realize in our life. My life is not right with God. I need something new. I need to be made new. And I can't do it myself. And then second, we're going to see, well, how does God make us new? How does it happen in our life? What does that look like? So the first thing I want us to think about is recognize you have to be made new. You have to be made new. So, and we're going to see that today with Nicodemus. We're not okay when we're left just to ourselves. Look at John 3, verses 1 through 3. Let's read that together. There was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to him at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you have come from God. And as a teacher, for no one could perform these signs you do unless God were with him." So Nicodemus is approaching Jesus. He's saying, look, you have to have come from God. You're doing amazing miracles, amazing signs. We know at least you're coming from God in some sense. And then Jesus replies back to Nicodemus. He says, "I assure you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. And so Nicodemus has been traveling around with Jesus around Jerusalem, and he's seen him do miracles. He's one of the crowd that is talked about in John 2. And yet we see him right away. How does he come to him? He comes to him at night, right? Well, when you go and see somebody at night, usually you're trying not to be seen, right? And so he's trying to go a little bit undercover so that the other good religious Jewish people don't see him. But also in the book of John, when you hear the reference to night, it's a reference more often than not to a spiritual darkness. So in a very real way, as we're going to see, Nicodemus, though he thought he was living in spiritual light with God, he was living in a sense of spiritual darkness. He didn't have a full understanding of who God was or where he was with God. And so there's more than one meaning here. The fact that he's going at night, it should open our eyes. I mean, something is wrong here. Right? Something is wrong with this guy. And yet he approaches God and he says, he approaches Jesus and he's trying to compliment him, right? Wow, you're from God, you're doing great things. And yet he assumes that he's just another prophet or just another man come from God, but he misses the reality of why he needs this Jesus. In his mind, he's just trying to add to what he already knows. Right? He's a Pharisee. A Pharisee were the kind of the teachers in the Jewish culture. They were the leaders, the people that others looked to so that they could learn more about God. And so as a good Pharisee, he's wanting to learn more so he can teach others. So he sees Jesus as just another resource, right? Just another guy that he can learn from so he can teach others and live that out and add to his own things that he's done in his life. And so we see that this is true of who Nicodemus is. He thought he already had God. He just wanted to add to that. And let's be clear. If there was anybody in Jesus' day who could be right with God on their own, it would be Nicodemus. I mean, this guy was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was a leader among the Jewish people. He spent his whole life trying to live up to God's standards. And he kept hundreds, if not thousands, of rules and just kept, like, check them off. Check off the box. I got this one done for today. Check this one off, right? And some of these were like, you can't take more than so many steps on a Sabbath day or you're breaking God's law, right? So he's counting how many steps he takes. And this is a guy who's serious about wanting to follow God, and yet Jesus is opening his eyes to the fact that he's not right with God. In spite of all he's tried to do. So in our minds today, if we think about who this would be, in our culture, this is somebody who is in the church every time the doors are open. This is somebody who memorizes entire books of the Bible. He can quote them off to you. This is somebody who talks about God all the time. And if people are around him, man, I would just wish this guy would quit talking about God, right? Quit telling me what I need to do. That's who Nicodemus was. And yet, what we're going to see here is, despite of all those things, he's not right with God. He may look like it to others, but he's not. And he's a guy that others would look up to. He's got this great knowledge. He's got these great gifts of teaching to others, speaking to others. High standing in a religious community. He'd be like a deacon or a pastor in a church. Right? He's recognized as somebody who knows what he's talking about. And Jesus just shoots straight with him. He doesn't pull any punches. He doesn't compliment Nicodemus. Hey, thanks for recognizing I'm coming from God. Now, he doesn't say that, right? He doesn't say that to Nicodemus. He doesn't thank him for following or coming to him. He just shoots it straight and he says, look, you haven't done enough. You haven't done enough to get into God's kingdom. You must be born again. That's what he tells him. When we think about God's kingdom, this is what's at stake here, right? God's kingdom. What is God's kingdom? Well, a kingdom is when somebody is king, right? There's a ruler. And so God's kingdom means that God is ruling our life. That he has conquered the evil, the sin in our life. He's taken over. He's now ruling in our lives instead of those things. Right? And so Jesus is telling Nicodemus, no, you are not living under God's rule. You're living under something else. The rule of Satan, the rule of evil and sin in your life. Even though you don't even know it. You have to be born again to enter into God's kingdom. You need a brand new life. That's what it means to be born again. Right? You're starting over. Could you imagine a child being born again? They're starting over. Right? A brand new life. You got to rethink everything and become new. Now you can imagine how shocking this would be to Nicodemus. Right? This is a man who is priding himself on how good he is. In his mind, he's, man, I've got this together. I've got this figured out. Others are looking to me. And all of a sudden, his world just gets rocked by Jesus, right? He's turned upside down. Because Jesus has enough gumption to tell him he's not good enough. He hasn't done enough. Now, when we think about our lives, we don't like it when people tell us we haven't done enough or we're not good enough, do we? Anybody think back to a moment where somebody told them, you haven't done this job quite good enough. You need to do it again. What do? We're like, what? Excuse me? You just told me that? Right? No. You go on your way. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Right? And so there's really two ways we respond when somebody tells us we're not good enough. First thing we do is we respond kind of out of this pride in our life, and we get angry. Right? I coach soccer for my son's team, and some kids, I've noticed, you try to instruct them and teach them, hey, you need to improve this a little bit. Try doing this. Try this little drill or whatever. And they just shut you down, man. They're just like, I'm not listening to you. I've got it together. I know what I'm doing. And they just kind of go off and pout. This guy doesn't know what he's talking about, right? That's pride. That results in an anger towards what I'm trying to help him with. It's angry pride. We respond that way in our lives when people try to tell us we're not doing something right. Or the other side of the coin is we get insecure and we get down on ourselves, right? There's other kids on the soccer team who you have to be really gentle with in instructing them because they already think they're not good enough. And if you tell them something else, they're going to be, man, I just give up. I can't do this. I'm just going to sit this out. Right? I'm not good enough to do this. And we often fall into these categories in our lives. Don't we? We tend to fall on one or the other more often than not. And we can think about God that way. Because God has all... So with the pride aspect of it, think about it this way. Man, God has all these rules. He thinks I'm not good enough. How can he expect that out of me? I can't keep those things. And so what we do is we try to think better about ourselves, right? We try to think, well, I'm doing a lot for God. He's got to let me into heaven. He's got to let me... into knowing him, because I'm doing enough already. So we just kind of ignore what he's really trying to tell us, and we just shut down from him and think, well, I'll do what I'm doing. It's going to be good enough, I hope. I hope. Surely we'll be good enough for him. So that's the pride aspect of it. On the other side, some of us may think, man, God has all these things. I could never live up to him. I'd give up. I could never do what God wants me to do. So why even try? Right? God's not going to accept me because I don't go to church enough. I do too many bad things. I don't read my Bible or pray enough. Should I just give up? But we need to see the fault in both of these ways of thinking. Because in reality, both of these types of thinking are all dependent on us. Right? It's what we can do. We're saying, well, I've got to go to church, or I've got to read, or I've got to do these things. I'm hoping I'm doing enough. You see that? There's no reliance on God at all in those things. And that goes completely against the message of what God has done for us. It's not about what we can do. And we're just like Nicodemus in thinking that way. And we look at others that way too, don't we? We look down on others. Man, they're not good with God. They're doing all these other things. They don't deserve that because they're not doing enough good. Like we do deserve, right? Do we deserve anything? No, the Bible tells us we don't deserve anything. All we deserve is condemnation from God. And yet he freely out of his grace gives us good things. So we need to see if we're falling into either of these categories towards ourselves or to others, this is not in line with what Jesus says. He says, no, you have to be born again. You don't need to do anymore. You need to be born again. And so Jesus shows us we can never do enough for God. We need his help. We need him. We need him alone. And that's what he wants us to do. He wants us to look outside of ourselves and realize it's not in us. He's got to do it for us. We've got to look to him. And we've got to have this radical heart transformation that changes the core of how we think and who we are. So that we're not relying on ourselves, but we can only trust in what he's done. And that means we have to come to the end of ourselves. We need to be made new. Plain and simple. There's nothing more. I give up, God. I'm trusting you to do this. So we see here that we have to realize that. Right? We have to realize we have to be made new. Yet we also know we can't make ourselves new. Right? We can't do it. We are who we are as we're born into this world. We can't make ourselves new. So that means we have to look to him. That's the second thing we're going to see. We're going to see how God makes us new. How God makes us new. So Nicodemus is obviously confused by what Jesus says. Be born again? What are you talking about? That's physically impossible. You can't do that. And so that's what we're going to see here in these next few verses. So let's start in verse 4 of John 3. But how can anyone be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked him. Can he enter his mother's womb a second time and be born? So you see right there, right? Nicodemus is thinking in physical terms. He's at the end of himself. What does this mean? And Jesus sets him straight. He's not talking about physically being born again. Starting verse 5. Jesus answered Nicodemus. I assure you, unless someone is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh. Whatever is born of the Spirit is spirit. So Jesus makes a clear line of distinction. There's got to be two births. Right? All of us have to be born physically. And now we have to be born spiritually. Flesh, spirit. Flesh, spirit. Two births. Two different types of births. And then in verse 7, do not be amazed that I told you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases, and you hear its sound, but you don't know where it comes from or where it's going. Well, so it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can these things be? Asked Nicodemus. Are you a teacher of Israel and don't know these things? Jesus replied. So it's still a mystery. Nicodemus does not fully understand this. We see that he is not grabbing on to what Jesus is trying to say. He's not understanding, even though he's the most religious guy in the city. He's not understanding. And so the crux of that, the key question we see here, and Jesus is trying to answer is, what does it mean to be born again? What does that mean? And the truth is, we need to understand that question because Jesus says, this is how you enter the kingdom of God. We need to know that and be convinced of it. And the answer is really in verse 5. A person has to be born of water and the Spirit to enter the kingdom of God. So what's he talking about, water, Spirit? It's really a reference to the Old Testament. So I'm going to read Ezekiel 36, verse 25 through 27. This is what it means, water and Spirit. All right? This is a prophecy, what God is going to do, and he's going to do it through Jesus in Ezekiel. I will also sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and all your idols. So what's water mean? It's a cleansing, right? Water cleans us. And specifically, God's going to represent his cleaning of our sin, of our impurities, all the things that are messed up in our life, all the bad things. He's going to clean us of those things and make us pure. That's what water is. And then he says in verse 26, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. There's the word spirit, right? Water and spirit. And with that spirit, I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Flesh is a feeling, right? A desire, a new feeling. Whereas stone, you're just hard. Right? You don't know God. You're hardened to him. But flesh, now you're softened to who he is. In verse 27, I will place my spirit within you and cause you to follow my statutes and carefully observe my ordinances. So there you see it, right? He's putting his spirit in us. That's being born again. A new spirit. And God has to do this. Only he can make us clean. We can't make ourselves clean. What we've done, we've done. All the bad, negative things in our life, we've done it. We can't make ourselves clean from that. He's got to do it. And then he's got to give us a new heart to not want to do those things anymore. That's the new spirit. This is how spiritual birth happens. So we see this is all over the New Testament, right? God is, the whole point of the Old Testament is to point us to Jesus. To say, hey, you can't save yourselves, guys. All these laws that I'm giving you, you keep breaking them. Right? You need somebody else that will keep every single one of them in your place. Because that's my standard. And you need to trust in that person. And so Nicodemus should be understanding these things, right? He's an Old Testament teacher. That's what he is. The Pharisees live by the Old Testament, and yet he misses the whole point of it. He's just doing things, thinking that it's good enough. Not looking at the truth that he's breaking things too. And what he needs most is a new heart. And so how does all this happen? Well, if you look at Ezekiel, you look at what Jesus is saying here, it's all by God's grace, right? Is God doing it in spite of our undeserving of it? God's grace is what is happening here. Verses 6 through 8. Born of the flesh leads the flesh. Born of the Spirit leads the Spirit. How many of us in this room could give birth to a new spirit in our life? Not going to happen, right? God's got to do that for us, and that is grace. The fact that he does it for us. You see how undeserving we are of that, and yet he gives it to us anyway. He changes our hearts, and he gives us life with him and under his rule. And it's all by his grace. And we can't control it, and we can't comprehend it either. It's a mystery. And the Bible refers to salvation as a mystery. Look at verse 8. He compares it to the wind. Jesus compares our spiritual birth to the wind. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear it sound, but you don't know where it's going or where it's coming from, right? Now, think about it. The wind, we know it's there, but we can't tell exactly where it's coming from or where it's going. It just happens, right? And it's the same way when God works in our life. We can't predict when God is going to work in us. You can't see it coming from a mile away. If you have experienced that in your life, you know it. God just overwhelms you with this sense at some point in your life, and you're like, wow, where did that come from? God has just done something life-changing in me. That's what it means to be a Christian. We can't predict it, and we can't control it, right? God's going to do what he's going to do. We can't say, God, do this, or do this, or come now. We can ask him to, but we can't control it. And God wants us to ask him to. That's what prayer is all about. But ultimately, we have to trust him to work when he's going to work. Right? And so we see here, this is God's grace. And it's like the wind. And it makes us, as a result, completely dependent on Him. Right? That's what it means. You have to completely depend on Him to work. You can't make it happen. And some of us in here are kind of control freaks and we like to make stuff happen. We can't do that here. We're completely dependent on God and what He does. And Jesus is giving here for us, He's giving us an inside view of what happened to us if we know Christ. He's telling us we can't save ourselves. And He's telling us, look, God has done this in you. He's worked and changed your heart. As a result, you need to worship Him and quit trying to do it on your own. Give your life fully to Him. Don't think about yourself. And when we understand that, when we understand this grace that He has done in us that we couldn't do ourselves, it's going to change us. This is an unbelievable gift from God. To be born again, to be made completely new in spite of all we've done, and made new to know God and to live with Him and under His rule forever. The perfect God, the holy God, who has nothing wrong with Him, we get to know Him and live with Him. It changes us when we understand that. We want more of that. We want to know Him more so that we can be more like Him. And we can live in His presence. Become like Him. We want that for us. When we experience the reality of the gift and the grace of what He's given us. That's how change happens. You want to see people in your life change their actions? Pray for God to change their heart. And it will lead to change action. Don't just try to fix the outward problem, because it's going to happen again. And maybe in our own lives, we have some kind of pattern in our life that we recognize, man, this is a problem in my life. Recognize it comes from the heart. And the heart change comes from realizing the grace of God. And realizing what He's done for you. And living in that reality. Instead of your own reality. Right? This is what we need. This is what Jesus is showing Nicodemus here. And He's showing us. Only God can do this. Look to Him. Quit looking to yourself. Because the truth is Nicodemus was in the way of himself. Wasn't he? He couldn't see God because he was looking at all he had done. And that's what we've got to get out of our own way. If we're going to see God clearly, we've got to lay aside and be honest with God. And say, man, I can't meet your standard. I need Jesus to do that for me. We've got to get out of our own way and look to Him. So as we think about what Jesus is saying here, being born again, is that you? Have you ever been born again? Have you been made new? Is there any evidence of it in your life? Or are you still looking to what you do? Checking off the boxes in your own life. It's been a pretty good week. I went to church this week, read the Bible a couple days. Prayed at night before bed. I did pretty good, right? You're missing the point. If that's what you're doing. It's not about those things. It's about, do you know Christ? Are you falling more in love with Him because of what He's done for you? And all those other things are like nothing compared to what He's done. They're simply expected results of knowing Him. Do we realize that? I think we put a lot of stock in what we do a lot of times. God, what we should be doing is, I read the Bible today. God, I thank you for giving me the desire for even wanting to read the Bible. Right? Instead of checking off, yeah, man, I did pretty good. God, you gave me, you alone in my life, because I've been born again, has made me want to read the Bible. I deserve no credit for that at all. Right? And we need to know this God because of who He is. So is that you? How are you approaching your own life? Is it as a result of what God has done, or are you trying to earn your way? Maybe God has shown you that reality in your life today. Maybe you've been trying to do it yourself. You're a pretty good person. But that's not enough. Nicodemus was a good person. Jesus died so that you could be clean, right? So He could cleanse you of your impurities, the water part. And He rose from the dead so that you could live with his Spirit in you. Right? We have to trust wholly and completely in that. And that alone. So if that's you and you realize, man, I've not experienced this. I've been relying on myself. You need to respond today to what God is laying on your heart. You need to trust in God's word alone in your life. And put yourself completely on Him and commit your life completely to Him. If you are a Christian, see what God has done for you. See that today. Be amazed at the fact that you have been born again. That's an unbelievable reality that God has done. That you couldn't make it happen and God has done it for you. Because He loves us. He sent His Son to die for us. To make us new. Are you amazed at that reality? Is every single day you wake up amazed at the reality that you are now born again? That you're a new person in Christ? Does that amaze you? We should never, ever get past being amazed at that. It should change us every day. We should wake up every morning, God, you have made me new. What can I do for you today? That should be the heart that is in us. And we have to find ways to do that, right? It's easy to lose track. We have to find ways in our life. This is what I want to challenge you. If you're a Christian today, find ways to be confronted with this reality of what Jesus has done. Remind yourself of that. And let it deepen your love for Him. Let it deepen your love for Him so your heart is changed and you become more like Him. But being made new by Jesus, it changes us to the core. We have no reason for pride in anything we do. We recognize that it's all grace. We have no reason to boast in anything in our life. And we have every reason to live for Christ alone. Alone. Not us. All right, let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this picture of what it means to be born again. Of what it means to be made new by Christ. Lord, I pray if there's any of us in this room who feel like we have been trying to do it on our own. We've been putting our hope in our own efforts. Maybe even feeling like we're failing at it. That we realize that we can be set free from the bonds and the chains of our own good works. Lord, it is a freeing thing to know that it's not up to us to be right with you. That Jesus has done that for us. And yet in that freedom we recognize there's going to be a change in trusting in Him. Because we owe our lives to Him. And it's a joy to know Him. So we're going to live differently. We're going to live for Him. God, help us to be amazed at the reality of who you are and what you've done in us today. If there's any who don't know you, who haven't put their hope in Christ, they put it in something else, that today would be the day that they do that. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.